Hi, welcome to Mailbag Monday, and yes, sorry I haven't been doing videos recently. I have been pretty sick with a virus for over a week now, and it's just starting to get better, but this is all the energy I can muster, I'm afraid, so sorry about that. I've been taking it very slowly indeed. So anyway, thought I'd do another mailbag. I did a postcard one the other day, and that went down like a lead weight. So I uploaded the video and got most people saying that they didn't like it. So I moved it to my Alternate Zone channel. So if you want to check out the postcards from the mailbag, go to my Alternate Zone channel. The link will be down below. So this will be a regular mailbag minus those postcards. I just wanted to mention that I got this in the mailbag, but it wasn't actually a mailbag. It was just sent to me regularly. It's the Digilent Basis 2, if that's how you pronounce it. It's a Xilinx FPGA demo board, and basically the same sort of price target market, that sub-$100 market, as the Altera-based DEO Nano from Terra ASIC. Or Terasic, and so I now got both of these to do some FPGA videos with. So if you've got ideas for like comparisons and stuff like that, I can do two of probably the most popular boards on the market. So there you go. I've also got the Papillo board as well somewhere. So anyway, I could do a three-way comparison, but they're probably the two main competing FPGA demo, you know, sort of beginner introduction boards in that sub-$100 price category. So anyway, hopefully do some more videos on those. But enough of that for today. It is mailbag. Well, Thursday, and there's my mailbag shelf. It's still sitting there. Sorry I haven't got around to all this stuff, but let's go through a few things. And yes, my voice is still awful. Sorry about that. Got down a few sundry items here. We'll check them out one by one. What do we got here? This one is from the old Dart Royal Mail from Jerry Sweeney. G'day, Jerry. He's from Ruislip in England. Fantastic. No idea. Let's have a look. Oh, almost dropped it. Electronic resistor. An electronic resistor. Let's have a look. What does he mean by electronic resistor? I wonder. That, you know, to me, electronic resistor is either a it's not even a decade resistance box. It's like a E-squared pot or something like that. No, it looks like it is a decade resistance box with jumpers. Ta-da! There we go. Oh, it's heat-sealed. Oh, well, it could be worse. Could be in those horrible blister packets. There we go. It's a decade resistance box with some big thumping ass terminals on it, that's for sure. Check those out. They're absolute monsters with little surface mount resistors on the bottom. Well, they're bigger than usual, but yeah, they're still not going to dissipate much power, you know, half watt jobs, something like that. So, oh yeah, there we go. Tells you on the front. Read the front, Dave, you idiot. 500 milliwatts, 1%, 7 decade program resistor from 1 ohm up to 1 meg. Available from jerrysweeney.com. Awesome. And they're just jumpers. That's it. Very easy, very simple. I like it. Now, I said I wouldn't read out the letters in the previous video, but I'll probably do it quickly if it has something relevant in it. Here we go. It's got a YouTube video of Jerry explaining why he bothered to make these little boards. Apparently sold a bunch of them to some EE folk, and there is a thread about it on the EEVblog forum. Beauty. Now, clearly he's got these configured in a serial arrangement and you can see that on the solder mask. I hate black solder mask. One of the reasons why I hate it is that you're very difficult to see the tracks through there, but you can see they've got the return path coming from the 1 meg decade over there and then going into all the common paths and then that snaking off down through there like that, and series all the way through. Now, I did a similar board to this many years ago, and it was actually a fully surface mount version where I didn't use, it was exactly the same configuration, you know, the series configuration with the seven decades, but instead of the headers, which Jerry's used here. I used 10-way dip switches on here. They were surface mount dip switches, and I had the surface mount resistors under the dip switches, and I fitted them on there, and it made for a very narrow, very compact, you know, it was like probably the size of that or something. It was really, really tiny and a lot more fiddly than this one, but it was much smaller though. So thanks, Jerry. Head on over to jerrysweeney.com if you want one of these puppies. Well, it turns out I may have missed a postcard in the previous video from Romania. Expediter is Angel Mihai. I cannot pronounce that whatsoever. Dr. P, is that his form username? Oh, there we go. Don't even have to get the knife out for that. Yes, it is a postcard, so sorry, I have a postcard on. Oh, look at that. Ooh, lovely Romanian stately home, is it? I like it. Let's have a, what does it say? Scenic. I can't even pronounce that. Sorry. Hi Dave, best regards from Romania and congrats on your effort on teaching electronics to the world. A good teacher is scarce. Thank you very much, Miha. Oh, I was reading the name backwards, one of those backward names again. There you go. Thank you very much, Miha. I'm sure I'm pronouncing it incorrectly. This is Romania. Sinai, Castuel Pelez. I'm hopeless. I give up. Thank you. Next up, we have Arthur Nigulowski, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, from Des Plaines, Illinois, in the United States of America. Australia? E? Should be an A. It's not Austria. It's not Australia E. It's Australia A. Anyway, let's open it up. And kind of feels postcardy, actually. Sorry if it's another postcard. It probably is. Yeah, it's another postcard. Sorry, I thought I'd nailed all the postcards, but apparently I haven't. Well, I can't even pronounce that. Can't even pronounce that. Florida at night. Brilliant. Well done. As it turns out, we do actually have some electronics in here. Dave, this is a very useful device. Please find out more about it. Oh, he set the chip and the development board. And yes, there's the chip and there's a little development board. What it is an Azotech. I've never heard of them, but it's a IQ switch ProxSense. So a proximity sensor device. There you go. Little 6-pin job. And yeah, it looks like you get to what serial data out of it or something. I don't know. Something. Let's have a look. Whoa. So here's the PC. Here we go. ProxSense IC is a fully integrated capacitive sensor device in three variants. Dual outputs, touch button, touch button or proximity sensor incorporated in a driven shield, or touch sensor proximity for metal overlays. Automatic antenna tuning implementation, automatic adjustment for optimal performance. Well, that's what you want. You want to just solder the bloody thing in and get it to detect your finger or whatever. You know, you don't want to dick around with it. Internal capacitor implementation, reference capacitor on the chip. Excellent. So that's why it looks like there's two caps on the board, but are they just bypass caps, I guess? Have to have a look. Or are they? No, they're LEDs, are they? I don't know. Have to have a look at that. And low power, nominal 3 volts to 5.5 volt supply. Neat. Advanced on-chip digital signal processing, uses selectable 4 power modes, 13 microamps in standby, not bad. IO sync and source, timeout for stuck key, blah 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 blah, minimum external components, touch 5mm by 5mm or larger. There you go. I've never heard of Azotech before. Well, I'm going to have to solder that chip on there and give this thing a burl, I think. Can't wait. And there's our little board. There's a couple of bypass caps, lead dropper resistors, and a input protection resistor on the front end. But there you go. Why they didn't go to the effort to just solder the chip on there, I don't know. But geez, I'm going to wire this thing up and see how she goes. The problem with these little mongrels is it can often be hard to see by eye where the pin 1 marker is. But you can see it there on the bottom left corner. You can clearly see the circle once you get it to the right angle of light. I'm shooting this through my x10 macro lens, so it looks pretty obvious on here, but Trust me, by naked eye, it's not that easy. You definitely want to double check. And yes, I'll foolishly attempt to solder this while I'm filming it as well. Because, well, I'm a glutton for punishment. So let's put a bit of flux on there, shall we? There we go, from my flux pen. And I hope you guys appreciate this, because this is a pain in the ass to solder stuff while the camera's in the way. Trust me. And there's our pin one marker up there by the looks of it. And so we'll get our chip and place it on. Already put our flux on there. Not doing the best job. There we go. That'll do. And then we'll tack a pin in place. And then we'll be able to solder the rest. That's one. Now we can just go in there and wipe the other pins, drag them out, and the solder mask takes care of that. And oh, my solder's on this side. I can't actually get around. God, I wish I could show you the weird ass angles I'm on, but I'm actually doing this, holding this one backwards, and like the soldering iron's actually facing towards my wrist. I can't show it, but geez, this is horrid. Sorry, I've just got to change the angle on that, otherwise I can never get in here. I'd be soldering backwards with one hand tied behind my leg and up my backside. It's the camera in the way. It's a real pain in the butt, actually. It really is. But, there we go. I've got a short on one of the pins there. That didn't go very smoothly. Soldering in front of the camera, I've said it before and I'll say it again, sucks ass. It drops my productivity by about 1,000% and makes me look like an absolute goose. And there it is, a little bit ugly, but job done. Now, I should probably solder the header pins on as well. I got it wired up on the breadboard here. Let's give it a go. 5-volt power supply. Hopefully the magic smoke won't escape. And I've just got a sense wire here as well that we can use as the capacitive sense and touch, because it does both. So no lead action whatsoever. But let's see. Hello, there we go. Look, yep, it's detecting my little finger from any direction, of course, around there. Try and sneak in through there. There we go, we can get a bit closer in there. But and now let's see what happens when I touch it. Yep, works a treat. Beauty. And according to the data sheet, it claims to work through 6 millimeters of plastic. Well, I've got two sheets here, and let's put those beside there. No, it's just going to instantly, maybe we have to repower, calibrate it. Yep, there we go. And yeah, my finger's on the backside. There we go. Putting my finger on the backside, that's more than 6 millimeters. Not a problem whatsoever. Brilliant. Now, it's supposed to have one wire data streaming as well, and that's supposed to come from the T-out / data pin, but our schematic up here shows T-out is actually connected to the lead, and I've hooked it up to the scope here, and really, we don't get anything except the lead output. Let me trigger that. There we go. And it's just the lead output. There's no one wire data there at all. Now you can actually program this chip externally if you've got the programmer and the software to do various modes, and it's obviously not programmed to do that, which is not surprising because they're using the only two outputs on this thing to drive those two LEDs. So you can't have both one wire data coming out of there and get the pulse stretch on the lead as well. So yeah, for this particular demo, that's how they've programmed it, but presumably if we had the program, we could just hook it up and reprogram that thing to get one wire data out, if that was useful to you. Presumably the one wire data would give you the actual raw data and tell you how close you actually were to the thing. It would give you and say, oh yeah, this close. And you'd be able to interpret that data and do whatever you want with it. And you'll notice, of course, it all has to do with the capacitive coupling, because if I bring my finger down from the top, I can get pretty close, almost touching, before that thing will even detect that I'm within proximity, let alone touching it. Obviously, if I touch the bare metal there, it recognizes that. But if I come in from the side like this, where there's a larger capacitive coupling between my finger, like the lower my finger gets like that, the greater the capacitive coupling. There you go. Get that probe out of the way. The more the capacitive coupling. Look at that. See, it's huge because we're in parallel like that, and we've got the parallel bit of the wire plus my finger in parallel. If I come in like that, of course, it's a little bit, it's not as good as what it is when it's in parallel like that. And of course, you don't need a direct electrical connection to say it's actually contacted too. It's, I can just touch the insulation of that wire, and in fact, not even touch it, just get, I think, really, really close to it, and I can make that switch on. So obviously there's some threshold detection value there that gets set when you actually repower that. So if I repowered that, say, let me repower that with my finger there. Okay, now it won't detect from this, or it should have a different detection distance. Oh, okay. It's a bit shorter. So thanks for that, Arta. That was quite neat. The Azotech capacitive touch sense controller. And of course, these are a dime a dozen these days. Lots of companies do it, of course, and they're, a lot of this capacitive touch sense technology is built into microcontrollers these days. Next up, we have B. Zinneman from Cambridge, Massachusetts, in the United States, and a screwdriver set. Normally I'd be very excited, but for my birthday I just got a whole set of these Whia, German Whia precision drivers. Like I've got Phillips, I've got nut drivers, hex drivers, and Torx, a complete set of all of them. And yeah, I hope they're not Whia drivers, but by the look and feel of this package, it seems like they could be some sort of precision screwdriver. So hopefully it's one that I don't have. So thank you very much, B, in advance. Although you can never have too many screwdrivers. I can always take them home and, oh bugger. Oh, here we go, look. Oh, pull tab to open. God, school for the gifted, for those who've seen Far Side. Oh goodness, no, hey, they're not, no, they're Swiss tool. Oh no, not that horrible garbage. I hate these padded envelopes, cushion mail. Oh, gonna need this to cushion the ass of the person I'm gonna kick who bloody invented these things. Now it's all over my bloody bench. Urgh. And it's another postcard, would you believe it? Jeez. And this one is from, yes, it's from Cambridge, Massachusetts. Looks like it's from a group. Hi, Dave. Some of us are really enjoying your vlog. As a token of our appreciation, we send you the screwdriver set, which we make bigger ones. Awesome. Cheers. Thank you very much. Shall remain nameless. But fantastic. From MIT, of course. And that's one of their campuses. There you go. Opened in 2002. Sydney Pacific Graduate Residence provides spacious accommodation and community facility for 700 students at MIT. Fantastic. Thanks, guys. And these are top quality Swiss tools. Fantastic. 100% made in Switzerland. All my Swiss viewers are getting very excited now. Individual serial numbers on the shafts and hand rubbed by nude virgins in Utopia Land. Oh, fantastic. I've got a size 0 and a, what have I got? Let's have a look. Sorry, I've got a cough. I'm sick. There we go. A 0.3 by 2 flat, a 0.4 by 2.5 flat, and Phillips 00 and Phillips 0. Fantastic. Thank you very much. Oh, I love Swiss tools. Impromptu tool shootout. The made in Germany Whia Phillips 00 against the Swiss tools Phillips 00. Oh, both got screw, the spinny caps on the top. No problem. This one is shorter. You can get them, you can buy them in different lengths on the Whia tools. I'm not sure about the Swisstools though. The Swisstools are individually serial numbered down in there, whereas the Whia ones are not. But I kind of like the look of the Whia ones better, but geez, I'm not a fan, not a huge fan of like the see-through, the translucent handle on the Swisstools, really, but feeling wise, going down like that, I gotta say, I'm getting a bit more purchase on the Whia, I think. Oh no, because this is a slightly longer handle on the Swiss. I do like the fact that it does have a bit of a stop on the end there. Manufacturing quality, it's got a little bit of a burr in there. Look at that, that's the molding point or something like that. And but the Whia has, instead of the that bowl, that bulge on the end, has little flutes in there to get a bit more purchase on that. But oh geez, I don't know, not much, you know. I think the Whia feels a little bit better to me, but I don't know, let's have a look at the tips. Now here's where you can really see the difference in the construction and finish of the two tools. The Swisstools one here on the bottom has just standard, looks like standard polished spring, you know, hardened spring steel, of course, and absolute finest quality. And they've obviously put some sort of coating or something on the end. I'm not sure. Sorry, haven't looked up any of the advanced details on that. Maybe extra hardened or something like that. But it almost looks like it's got a bit of surface corrosion or something like that. I know you're supposed to, like, you know, rub these and polish them with oil and all sorts of funky stuff like that. But you can see the difference with the Whia on the top with that chrome-plated finish all the way down the shaft and onto the tip there. Totally different construction methods for the two screwdrivers there. So I don't know, any metallurgy experts out there, is there a word for a metallurgist, for a, you know, a metal expert, is that the word? I don't know, but if they are, please let us know which one you think is the best out of these two puppies. And the Whia does seem to have a slightly wider, you know, triangle protrusion there on the bottom, for want of a better term. But there you go. I mean, these are probably two of the best, the finest quality precision screwdrivers on the market. But there you go. If you've got any good ideas about which one's better, lots of fanboy fights will start, I'm sure. But that's Whia Tools versus Swisstools. And just to match Jerry's decade resistance board, we've got a decade capacitance board. People love these things from Jebediah Moulton from Ackworth in GA, Georgia, I think. Oh, I might have got that wrong. Crack this one open. Jeez, they're not easy to get apart. What a pain. But anyway, we have a note and we have, more importantly, the board. In a static shielding bag. Ooh, there's a bit of height in that. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I think yeah, he sent them before, hasn't he? I remember I've got exactly the same one, but the decade resistance one I think he sent last time. It's exactly the same look and feel as last time. Let me see if I can dig it up. And there it is. Ta-da! I knew it was familiar. AtlantaRobotics.com with a hyphen in there. So this is the six-decade resistance box from 0 to 1 meg. And this one is from, looks like 2 puff up to 100 mic. Quite a usable range. I really, really like it. And there's nothing on the bottom, of course. There are actually reverse mount rotary wafer switches in there, quite neat, and all surface mount caps on the top. And it looks like even the high value ones, right up there. There we go, 25 mic, 33 mic, 50 mic, and 100 mic. Woohoo! Look at those puppies. Now the thing I'm always concerned about, of course, one of the biggest specs of a decade capacitance box like this is, of course, the voltage spec. I mean, for resistors, you kind of, you know, take it for granted. It's a fairly large, and for most capacitors, you know, regular ones, all the low value stuff, they're going to be, you know, 50 volt caps or something like that. So, you know, for almost most uses, it's not going to be a problem. But these higher values right up in here, like the 100 mic, for example, they could be as low as, you know, 6 volts or something like that. So you're going to be very careful. So I want to find out exactly what the maximum rated voltage of this thing is. And as it turns out, it comes with a comprehensive sort of, you know, data sheet, I guess you could call it. And dial 1, it tells you exactly what caps and what values and how many in parallel and stuff like that. Really quite neat. Then we've got a graph of the measured capacitance versus target capacitance. Fantastic. Look at that. So each one is individually measured, I guess. And there's the schematic, of course. Very simple for these decade capacitance boxes. And, aha, here we go. Looks like what we, offset applied from capacitance adjustment, measured offset at 100, looks like he's measured at 100 kilohertz. But here we go, mouser, aha, bill of materials. So we should be able to find the 100 mic, there we go, 6.3 volts. There we go, I was right, because these multi-layer caps, of course, the reason that you can get, when I was a boy, or even, you know, not that long ago, actually, you couldn't even, it was an absolute, you know, fantasy to get 100 microfarad in one of these multi-layered ceramic capacitors. But the manufacturing technology is so phenomenal these days. I mean, it's even an X5R, for goodness sake. That one's not too bad at all, the dielectric. But, yeah, because the layers are so incredibly thin in these things, only 6.5 volts maximum. So you've got to be careful there. And then on the 10 volts for the ones that use the 10 microfarad caps, and then 16 and go up. So it would have been nice if the top level data sheet here just mentioned the maximum voltage range that could be used on each of the decades. So thanks, Jebediah from AtlantaRobotics.com with a hyphen. And yeah, he's sure RF engineers might laugh at the capacitance PCB, but I find it useful for a variety of things. 555s, timer, delaying clock edges, one-shots. Absolutely. I've used, I built my first decade resistance, capacitance box, sorry, along with my first decade resistance box when I was, oh, geez, I don't know, 10 or something like that, very, very young, and I've lost it over the years, and I've never reacquired a decade capacitance box, never built another one, but so this one will come in very handy, thank you very much. And of course there are wiring configuration differences between the decade resistance box and decade capacitance boxes in general. The capacitance boxes are usually a parallel configuration, so you can actually, you know, parallel up multiple things. So you can, you know, set this to 10 microfarads over here and then tweak it with a smaller value in parallel like that. And the decade resistance boxes are usually wired in series so that you have to, you know, you can do the same thing. You can set it to 100k over here and then tweak it by 1 ohm increments over here. But to do that, of course, you have to be in series configuration. And next up, we have a circuit board from, yes, they're having a third suck of the savoy, I think, Smart Board. They're the ones who make little adapter, surface mount adapter slash soldering tutorial boards or whatever, which I've shown before. So it looks like we have a letter. Good day, Dave. Enclosed is our newest masterpiece. Ooh, it is a low-cost yet powerful development board. Ah, a full-on development board. There you go, for the Cypress PSOC 3 and 5LP. The version that is enclosed is with a bootload of the most powerful PSOC available. We sell it in this configuration for only $35. Sounds cheap. I'm not sure if you've used PSOC before. I have dabbled in them. I've dabbled with a few development boards way, way back. Geez, I don't know how long. That was probably at least 8 years ago now, I think. Long way back. But those who use it swear by it. It is much more versatile than other embedded solutions because you define its full functionality. Because we offer it bootloaded, a programmer is not necessary given you the convenience of the Arduino. Ooh, there you go. I thought smart boards only did smart boards, but they're not. They're into development boards now. Resources, dip package layout, blah, 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 30 I.O., blah, 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 blah. You can, I'll put the link in. You can read about it. Can be found at. Ooh, at? Can be found at. Where's the link? I'll find a link and put it in. But let's have a look at this little puppy, which they flog for $35, which seems quite reasonable. It's, you know, Arduino price. And, whoa, look at that. There you go. They've obviously used their own smart board soldering technique there. Let's have a closer look. Yeah, they've used those big long embedded trench solder trenches there. So they're, eating their own dog food here by doing that. I really like that. Got a tiny little not standard 0.1 inch header down here. Presumably that's the programming interface for it. I don't know. Haven't read the documentation. I'm winging this. And got some other headers and jumpers and stuff, which I'm sure if you read the manual, you can do it. And we've got the USB interface, which hooks up. I mean, for me to test this, I'd have to load up the full PSOC software and everything else. But there you go. That looks like a neat little board if you're into the PSOC stuff. And it's got a boost converter on board. And that's about all she wrote there. But and it's a DIP format, so you can just plug it directly into your breadboard. I like it. Now, the thing about the PSOC chips, of course, is that they are I think they were probably the industry's first programmable analog solution. So you've heard of, you know, FPGAs, field programmable gateways, microcontrollers that now contain analog peripherals like analog to digital converters and stuff like that. Well, these PSOCs go one step further ahead and have reconfigurable analog elements on them. Things like op amps and ADCs and stuff like that. You can actually reconfigure analog stuff in there. And in the case of the PSO version 3 core, it's basically an 8051 core. So it's, you know, the old school 8051 architecture, but a high performance version of it. And this one actually has a dozen or so 20-bit Delta Sigma analog converters in it, as well as some PLD logic as well. So these are really funky devices, and I should probably take a new look at them. So if you want me to have a play around with this thing and get the software fired up and maybe do a video on the PSOC technology, then let me know, because this looks like a really neat little board to do it for $35. Of course, you wouldn't want to, you know, start soldering these pain in the ass packages yourself. Even when you buy a smart board, you might as well just buy it, you know, pre-done, plug it into your breadboard. Bob's your uncle. Last and perhaps least, we'll find out, it's from DigiKey. You know I like DigiKey, except when they sent me that stupid million-page catalogue in the big postage satchel. Oh, man. I think I'm going to have to re-watch that video. Memories. And this feels like, I don't know what's in here. So it's not quite a catalogue. Or a book or anything like that. I don't know. What is it? A diary? What is it? No. What is it? DigiKey. It's a DigiKey pad. Thank greetings from DigiKey. Keeping tabs on the global electronic blah, blah, blah. Thank you very much. It's a diary. And is it that wanky projection DigiKey pen that we had last time? No, it's not. It's just a DigiKey. No, pen. No, how do you even? You got to screw the end. Oh, that pen's a bit of a big, fat, chunky pen, but, thanks, DigiKey. Hang on, it's a USB stick. Woohoo!